Earthquakes.
Earthquakes are one of the natural phenomena that have impacted the history of mankind the most. They have destroyed entire cities and taken the lives of millions upon millions of people. That's really nothing new. What is new is knowing how to resist them, how to survive and make safer buildings and safer infrastructure. This is indeed a very new phenomenon. And when it comes to earthquake proofing, there are two countries that have had to learn a lot. Chile and Japan are two of the most seismically active countries on the planet. Together, they account for almost 40% of all seismic activity that happens in the world. In fact, Chile has suffered the most powerful earthquake ever recorded, the Valdivia Earthquake in 1960. It recorded a magnitude of 9.5 on the Richter scale, a true cataclysm. But this is not so unusual when you consider that both Japan and Chile lie directly above the Ring of Fire, a stretch of 40,000 kilometers that accounts for most of the seismic and volcanic activity on Earth. In this zone, tectonic plates subduct, that is, one slides under the other, generating subduction zones. The movement of the plates is not constant or regular. It happens with sudden pulls, and when both plates are very stressed and have a lot of accumulated energy, they yield, let go, and move suddenly, generating strong earthquakes. That is why 90% of all earthquakes in the world and 80% of the most powerful ones, the megathrust, happen in the Ring of Fire. In fact, Japan and Chile's earthquakes are very similar in magnitude and duration. As you can imagine, this challenge comes with one choice, and that's adapt, or you'll die. Today on VisualPolitik, we're going to tell you how these countries manage to adapt, what the main differences between them are, and the great common challenge that Japan and Chile face. So listen up.
Chile and Japan, learning from mistakes.
The most destructive earthquakes have terrible consequences. We're talking about phenomena that can end the lives of tens of thousands of people in just a few minutes. Chile and Japan are the most advanced countries in seismic disaster prevention for one simple reason. Throughout their history, they've undergone terrible tragedies that have taught them a very valuable lesson. It's worth spending more at the outset to save on human and reconstruction costs. But to better illustrate the magnitude of what we're talking about here, let's focus on just one example. March the 11th, 2011 is one of those dates that we all surely remember. That day, a huge 9.1 magnitude earthquake was centered on the Miyagi Prefecture in Japan, but it shook a large part of the country, including the capital of Tokyo. The Great Eastern Earthquake and the subsequent tsunami left almost 16,000 people dead and more than 6,000 injured. And yes, we're talking about the same earthquake that caused the Fukushima disaster. This was Japan's latest megaquake, but the Japanese know that there's a 70% chance of another mega-earthquake happening in Tokyo in the next 30 years. And yes, okay, the vast majority, more than 85% of Tokyo's buildings are considered resistant, but the fact that 16,000 hectares of the Japanese capital is covered in wooden buildings, it does not help. According to some simulations, the gas leaks that are commonly produced by a large earthquake could cause fires throughout the city and could destroy more than 600,000 buildings. So the consequences, they go far beyond tremors and possible landslides. And of course, all of this generates awareness, both social and political. Meanwhile, in Chile, they are somewhat behind, but the shock of 2010 made them take risk prevention even more seriously.
An 8.8 magnitude earthquake shakes Chile. The earthquake, lasting 1 minute, was felt in the capital, where the electrical service was interrupted. The tsunami that the earthquake caused reached Hawaii.
Chile's earthquake affected 70% of the country's population, but thanks to anti-seismic regulations, only two of the capital's high-rise buildings collapsed. And in the face of such a strong earthquake, that was actually quite a success, especially considering the precedence of the Latin American region.
Chile's investments in resilient infrastructure, early warning systems, and urban planning have managed to ensure that this time the number of victims is low, despite the earthquake's intensity. Margareta Wallström, former Office Special Representative of the United Nations for Disaster Risk Reduction.
And this is what we need to repeat. As the saying goes, better safe than sorry. But how have Japan and Chile achieved these levels of risk prevention? How do their models differ? What are the weaknesses? And what are the keys to saving lives?
If there's a risk, get ahead of it.
When we talk about earthquakes, we must keep two things in mind. They're unpredictable and they're inevitable. However, what can be predicted and avoided are the risks that arise when an earthquake occurs. You see, earthquake damage prevention can be done in two ways, active or passive. For example, after the Valdivia earthquake of 1960, the strongest ever recorded, which caused a huge tsunami, the Pacific Tsunami Warning System and Mitigation System was created by the UNESCO Intergovernmental Oceanographic Commission in 1965, intending to disseminate early tsunami alerts. But don't worry, the age of the system shouldn't scare you. It's been updated over time. The fact is that this is one of the best examples of active prevention. A tsunami in the Pacific has a huge propagation capacity, and it can be very destructive. Usually, there is about a 20 to 30 minute window between an earthquake happening under or near the sea and a tsunami hitting the nearest coast. But in the case of the 2011 earthquake in Japan, in some areas, only 2 minutes passed before the alert and the tsunami making landfall. And of course, in the case of phenomena that require massive evacuations and which affect huge regions, early warnings are massively important. The more time people have, the better, and every second really does count. In fact, a strong earthquake originating in Chile can cause such a large tsunami that it can affect very distant coasts throughout the Pacific, such as Japan, New Zealand, America, and even the Philippines. And that is precisely why Japan also implemented its own early warning system, which has been greatly improved since the 2011 catastrophe. Since that year, more than $25 billion have been invested into earthquake sensors to reach 280 points. It's the densest and most reliable network in the world. However, the biggest challenge, by far, is passive prevention. That is, all those measures and standards that aim to minimize damage to buildings and therefore the number of victims. And in this, Japan is the undisputed leader.
Japan's strict building codes save lives.
But how exactly does it work? Well, check this out. Although the first Japanese anti-seismic construction regulations date back to 1924, most of the buildings have been built under two very different regulations. The oldest one, called Kyutaishin, dates back to 1950 and focused on preventing buildings collapse. The new code, or Shintaishin, from 1981, requires buildings to remain structurally sound and show, at most, only cracks after medium to strong earthquakes. These rules have, evidently, been partially reinforced over the years. It's precisely due to this that the structures of the buildings in Japan are mostly made out of steel, which is much more flexible and resistant to movement than rigid concrete. Furthermore, in some cases, crossbeams that absorb energy from the earthquake are also installed. And of course, they also have seismic dampers at the base of the tallest buildings. Chile, on the other hand, doesn't require buildings to withstand damage. Regulations are more oriented towards preventing their collapse. Its current regulation is more similar to the Japanese one of 1950. In this aspect, you can see the huge difference in vision that Chile has, where regulation is much less strict. That is to say, in Chile, they seek to save lives, but without requiring buildings to remain unscathed. And there's really a fundamental reason for this, and that's the cost. Building a building as resilient as those in Japan can cost around 10-15% more than a regular one. And of course, this makes housing prices in newer and more resistant buildings more expensive. The philosophy is, if you live here, you'll be safe. But hold on just a second. We're assuming that rules are always met and codes are always followed and that everyone is working for the common good when the truth might be rather different. In fact, do you know what the number one problem is that affects security and can cost many lives? Well, think about it for a second. Maybe you got it.
A attention. Corruption kills.
Yes, you heard that correctly. It might surprise you, but corruption is, without a doubt, the greatest threat to security in terms of earthquakes. And no, neither Japan nor Chile are free of this scourge, because even though Japan has the image of an ideal country and Chile ranks in at a respectable number 27 in the Corruption Perception Index, from time to time scandals like this one crop up. The KYB Corporation, a Japanese company dedicated to the development and manufacture of seismic dampers, admitted at the end of 2008 that they had falsified the quality and performance data of their products for more than a decade. To date, they haven't yet been able to quantify the real scope of the risk that this entails, but it's estimated that the effectiveness of the falsified products could be at around 86% of the minimum requirements required by law. Buildings as important as Tokyo City Hall, the Olympic Aquatic Center, and the Ariake Arena, home of the 2020 Olympic Games, used seismic dampers from this company. And as if that wasn't enough, the tallest tower in the world does too.
Tokyo Skytree, among buildings linked to data scandal at earthquake shock absorber maker KYB Corporation.
Although this case is quite serious, the truth is that Japan doesn't have much corruption, and that means that seismic regulations are followed most of the time. Chile, on the other hand, has the lowest corruption level in all of Latin America, which has contributed to the fact that anti-seismic regulations in construction are complied with in the vast majority of cases. Although, as we've seen, they are less stringent than Japan's.
We have a law that states that design of a certain height must be reviewed by an independent team that verifies that the standards are being met. No one builds without this backing. Sergio Sepulveda, geology scholar from the University of Chile, to El País.
But you know what? It's precisely this broad compliance with regulations that makes Chile a much safer country to live in than, for example, Mexico during an earthquake.
Corruption and negligence caused landslides during Mexico City earthquake.
Mexico, one of the countries with the highest corruption rates in the region, is also a seismically active country. The difference with Chile is that in Mexico City, every time there's a strong earthquake, several buildings collapse, leaving numerous victims. And although not all earthquakes have the same characteristics for reasons such as the type of soil and depth, Mexico City lost 228 people in the city alone and 369 across the entire country when an earthquake hit on September 19, 2017. On the other hand, the 2015 earthquake in Coquimbo, Chile, which was felt with an intensity of 7 in Santiago, only caused 15 fatalities throughout the country. This is a great example of earthquake prevention. Therefore, Mexico and other highly seismic countries need to catch up and work hard and honestly for the safety of their citizens. So I really hope you enjoyed this video. Please do hit that like button if you did. And please don't forget to subscribe for brand new videos. Also, please do check out our friends at the Reconsider Media podcast who provided the vocals in this episode that were not mine. Also, this channel is possible because of Patreon and our patrons on that platform. Please consider joining them and supporting us in our mission of providing independent political coverage. And as always, I'll see you in the next video.